exploit found two ways to get around this. The first way was to read a baryton memory, and it was able to calculate the native pointer of any object. So they created an array and calculated the native pointer and filled the array with the payload they wanted to execute. And the so the net called this function as it thought it was a constructor for class. And yeah, but what happens if we try to execute this with Pipelight? Well, actually, if you have your terminal open and start the browser from terminal, you will see this output. The first one is an assertion which was hit, and it says that we got a non-existing pointer, and yeah, the plugin is killed, and yeah, the second message is only that yeah, the pipe is broken. And yeah, why does this happen? Well, it's mostly case for caused by our handle manager, because the plugin does something it's not allowed to do. Here's a short snippet from this exploit code, and as you can see at the comment, it tries to call DOM reference object, but here the object which is referenced is actually created self-created objects, and all JavaScript objects must be created by the browser. Even if a plugin wants to create an object, it needs to tell the browser, oh, please create an object, here's my function table. And yeah, so we get an object which is created on the wrong side, and we do not have any entry for this object in our handle manager, and therefore we hit this assertion and killed the plugin before it was able to execute its payload. But in this case, it was just some luck, and yeah, this is not... Yeah, there's no guarantee that Pipelight helps in this case. So we
and the assertions were never introduced as a security feature, but in this case they seem to do the job pretty well. Yeah,
and so we searched for other possibilities to increase security a bit more. And yeah, first we took a look at what we have at the moment, and yeah, Pipelight hits to catches some of these things by assertions, but yeah, it's not really a security feature, as Sebastian already said. And then plugins sometimes often give you some sandbox, but as you can see, this is not always so good tested, and you can sometimes break out of it. And yeah, Wine is just translation layer, it does not do introduce any security. And so we searched for additional ideas, and some of the ideas are pretty easy, so we thought, oh, can we, for example, scan the code before we execute it so that there's no virus in it, but or remove the set drives, which points to the root file system, and check the access on each AP call. But all these ideas are mostly senseless, because you can still execute any native code, and the plugin could, for example, directly execute the syscalls from Linux, and yeah, this won't be catched by anything, and or generate opcodes at runtime. Yeah, we cannot catch it. So we worked on our own security system for Pipelight, and that's the Pipelight sandbox. It uses namespace features of the recent kernels to separate the plugin from the rest of the system. And well, the first use namespace is the PID namespace, so that the plugin cannot see any other running processes. It cannot send any signals to other processes. It won't see them. It will just see itself or the plugin loader.
And just a small remark. Basically, the Linux side is still the same, but the just the Windows side, which actually loads the DLL with the code which may contain bugs, this part is executed in the sandbox.
Yeah, and we also have a mount namespace, which marks the whole file system as read-only, except the wine prefix, so that the plugin can actually create files and such stuff, but it won't be able to edit your home directory. Yeah, you have to disable some features like the menu builder or menu updater, which tries to create desktop icons, which won't work as you cannot write into the home directory, so it will just prevent some error output. But this works pretty well. And we also introduced an IPC namespace so that you cannot see any sockets outside. For example, we found out that the easiest approach to break out without an IPC namespace is GNOME Terminal, because it allows you, if you start a new terminal, to directly send one command to another terminal which is running via dbus. And yeah, so we disable this. And we also try to restrict the network access. So for example, if you get a virus into your wine prefix, that it cannot access any local IP addresses, so that you don't infect any other PCs on your network. And Yeah, it basically protects you of any kind of manipulation, but it's not only designed to work with Pipelight. It can run almost any Linux program, and it's highly configurable. You can say, oh, if you want X server access or Pulse audio, if this should work, you can disable network access completely. This is the most secure possibility. And you can define which directories can be written to. And this works especially good with Vine, as Vine only needs write access to the Vine prefix and some temp directory. And yeah, you can run most of the software with this without having some problems. Sometimes it's a bit difficult with the X server access when you want to use OpenGL. It depends on the driver. If you disable memory mapping, shared memory, if you try to disable shared memory, this does not always work anymore. But for example, the NVIDIA driver works pretty well, and we had some problems with Intel, but we'll take a look if we can fix it. And we still have one big issue left. You can steal information this way, because if you allow network access, you can still read the whole file system and send the data out to the internet, or you could show up some password dialog to the user when you have X server access, and if the user types in the password, you can also send it out to the internet, but you won't be able to do any modifications to the normal system. And it's still better at the moment, so you use it at your own risk. Okay. Now we come to our conclusion. You have now seen the various parts of Pipelight, how the communication works between the Linux and Windows part, how we implemented the X-Embed stuff, and how we try to improve the portability between the plugins and the browsers and the security. But there are still some ideas left which we would like to implement. We would also like to extend the APIs we support. We tried some additional features on the Pepper API. It's a bit complicated, as the Pepper API is always sandboxed. It's difficult to start Vine if you are sandboxed and cannot fork yourself, execute anything. So currently it works only if you disable the sandbox. But we try maybe to use some sockets that will start a service. So if you start the plugin, it will connect to the socket and then use the socket for communication, as sockets to localhost are still allowed, but you cannot execute any programs. And ActiveX were also interesting, because for Windows RT on ARM, there, for example, exists a Flash plugin, but it's only in the ActiveX version, and there's no NPAP version, as no other browsers are allowed. And we tried to load the ActiveX version of Flash on other ARM devices with Vine, and it worked quite good, but we need to implement this API to make it work with Pipelight. And also, some of you have heard that, for example, Netflix want to use the encrypted media extensions of HTML5 in the future, and it still requires a binary blob, which is provided by Netflix, and if they do not create a Linux version of it, it will still not work, although it's HTML5. So we may take a look into this, if we can also execute such a binary blob with Vine, so that you can use it with HTML5 later. And I think this might be also interesting for other programs, some of the concepts we have shown, and there are also some small ideas. So, any questions?
I think on your website you described that your first attempt, what you did first was try to run Silverlight in Firefox that is running in Vine, and you found that to be pretty slow.
Yeah.
Do you have, did you do any debugging why running Silverlight in a Windows browser on Vine is slow, but not running Silverlight via Pipelight?
Well, there are also some, that's not the only problem, there were also some redrawing problems. We have seen that there are glitches in the image drawing, but I don't know what the reason for this is, but it's rather difficult, because Firefox also used a lot of API calls and it was not working correctly, so we just searched for a better approach.
So from a user perspective, your approach is pretty better, but there are some Vine bugs apparently that need to be solved.
Yeah, Eric is still using the old approach with the Vine, so maybe he will do some additional debugging.
Any further question? Yeah.
The security you mentioned, the local network access is stable. Does that mean that if, let's say, we have streaming media from a local address, can't access that?
if you try to access a local, it's normally blocked, but yeah, we thought about allowing exceptions so that you can say, oh, there's a streaming server, allow this IP address, but at the moment it's currently blocked because normally you won't have a Netflix server on your local network.
But you all also have to differentiate between the a plugin can use different methods to request stream, and one method is to directly use the NPAP. This is not affected by the sandbox at all, so if it uses just NPAP to request such a stream, it will still work, but only, unfortunately, most of the plugins also use additionally the Windows API, so in this case, you're right, it wouldn't work to access such a device immediately, but you have to add it as an exception.
Yeah, it's very unusual that a plugin request does a request through the browser because it's limited to HTTP. So the most plugins use WinSox to also access other protocols. So I think it's very unlikely that you will get an infection through this HTTP channel. Other questions?
You mentioned that the Adobe Reader sandbox doesn't work because it makes some assumptions about NTDL. Can you quickly describe what those assumptions are, or is this highly technical?
If I remember correctly, they basically assume that two functions they use are in different pages, and they actually change the permissions of this page. And in case of Adobe Reader, in case of Vine, both is in the same page, so they basically remove access from the code they still need afterwards, so and that's why it crashes.
Yeah, I think it was removing the executable flag of the memory protection change API command and was not able to change it back and crashed then. So it's more like they tried to change function pointers and such stuff so that a function, the plugin cannot directly call it but must go through the sandbox, and they messed something up.
Oh, okay.
It also might be possible that it probably works with some specific Vine versions where by accident both of the functions were in different pages, but at least with the version we tried it didn't work. So,
but there's also Vine bug which you can take a look at.
So it's not something that's fixable by making a few more functions hookable. That's my favorite way of dealing with those things. Let's make it hookable.
Yeah, if this is an accepted solution, I can write a patch for it. No. Any further questions?
What do you do to install dependencies and plugins? Do you use like Winetricks or something underneath?
No, we have implemented all the necessary stuff ourselves. Basically, it's one shell script which downloads and installs all the stuff, and
So you build your own little database table or table with all dependencies.
Yeah, there aren't so many workarounds required yet, so it didn't make any sense to include the whole Winetricks. These are just a few DLLs, and it was pretty straightforward to directly download and extract them to the specific directories.
And Winetricks has a disadvantage that they often use the Windows 2000 SP4 service pack, if I remember correctly, and it has a size of 200 megabytes or more, and if you want just a single DLL, it's a bit lot to download. There are often some other update packages which also include the same DLLs, which are only 3 or 4 megabytes big.
You told before that you download some DLLs which are broken in Vine. In which area? Or what's missing? Do you send
There's, for example, an MPEG2 splitter, which is required for some of the Silverlight applications. I'm not sure if there's a bug report yet. I don't think we filed one yet, but I think it's pretty unlikely that someone will write this just in a few days because video stuff and MPEG2 isn't that easy, especially to figure out how everything works on Windows. I don't think there's any documentation available what the Windows part contains exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, I think the broken DLL, for example, would be WinInet, which has some problems with NTLM auth, so the Windows authentication, because first of all, the password dialog doesn't work at all currently. So if you enter a password, it won't even reach the NTML auth code. And the other problem is, if you fix this, the WinI does not pay attention to the correct behavior, because with NTLM auth, only every single connection must be, must have a three-way handshake. But WinI tries to reuse the token,
just the previous
token from another session, and then the server will respond, oh, this is invalid, and Wine won't try to request it again, and we have many failed requests. It was mostly used by a database client, which was used based on Silverlight, and so
If there are any WinInet guys that probably are experienced with the code, we can of course provide some more details. We also did some debugging, but haven't figured out this error yet.
Yeah, the WinInet guys are here, but they're not raising their hands.
What did you say?
He said he's one of the WinInet guys. It's okay. All right. Well, thank you, guys.
If you have any additional questions, you can also send us an email or find us on Freenode on Piper Channel.